Hello everyone, you're all very welcome to the launch of Attac Ireland. So my name is Marie Moran and I'm a member of the working group of Attac Ireland, and we've been working for a number of months now to get Attac Ireland off the ground. First of all, we're very pleased to host the Irish stage of the European tour of Les Économistes Atterrés, which translates as the Appalled or Horrified Economists. If you visit their website, you'll see that it says, we are economists and we are appalled. And probably most of you here would be able to have good guess as to why that's the case. So in short, they are appalled at the development of a neoliberal economic orthodoxy, which dictates state policy, which is taught in universities, and basically which legitimizes the subjugation of all social and human needs to the demands of the markets, and particularly and increasingly the financial markets. And whether or not you know the word neoliberalism, you'll know what it is, because it's all around you and it dictates your life chances and those of your friends and families. And it's basically an economic way of thinking that puts the needs of the market above all else. So we know this, we see this in things like the austerity programs, the government cutbacks, shrinking of government spending, privatization of social services, the prioritization of competition above all else, and the freeing up of trade and capital flows to enable the maximization of profit, whatever the social or environmental cost. So the Appalled Economists formed because, despite the fact that the economic crisis that we're still living through can be traced back directly back to these kinds of economic decisions and ways of thinking, economic thinking at the time and since then hasn't really changed. The Appalled Economists developed and formed in order to offer a new way of thinking and to say there's a different way of thinking economically and a different way of doing things. So Esther is going to say a bit more about this in her talk, and I will introduce Esther more formally in a moment's time, but I just want to fill you in more quickly on the rest of the events associated with the launch of Attac. Okay, so after Esther's talk, what we will do is we'll have a short break and then we'll go to the first sort of official meeting of Attac Ireland. We're really, really pleased to introduce Esther Jeffers, who is a lecturer at the University of Paris VIII, a member of the Scientific Council of Attac France, and a specialist on shadow banking and finance in the Euro area. And most importantly for today's events, she's also a member of Les Économistes Atterrés, and this, as I was saying, is the Irish leg of their European tour, which is based on challenging this neoliberal orthodoxy I mentioned previously. So she will also tell you a little bit more about Les Économistes Atterrés, and the title of her talk today is Bringing Light to European Shadow Banking. So Esther will speak for about 35 or 40 minutes, and then we'll have questions and answers and a discussion. Okay, so that's great. Over to you, Esther. Thank you.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for giving me this opportunity. As Mary said, today's the Irish meeting of a European tour sponsored by the EuroPen. EuroPen is a European organization that brings together progressive economists, and it's a progressive economist network. It brings together economists, researchers, trade unions, ONGs, you know, civil society organization. If you would like to find out more about the European network, you could go to the website by following the link on the slide. And this European network has a chapter, sister organization in different European countries. In France, it's Les Économistes Atterrés, but it has also sister organization in Spain, in Belgium, in Germany, and in Greece, and different European countries. And the last meeting of European meeting will take place in France in June. What brings together these economists and the civil society organizations, our refusal, it's to say no to the austerity measures that have been imposed on the European countries. Since the beginning of the crisis, what we have seen is that European leaders and European governments have bailed out banks and the financial sectors without any conditions. Whereas when it comes to the European states and countries who had to rescue the financial sectors, it's putting drastic condition on these European countries to access the emergency funds that they are providing. And so the consequence is that these austerity measures, far from bringing out the European countries out of the crisis, it's deepening the crisis and it's widening the debt in these countries. And it's transferring the burden of the rescue of the crisis, of the financial sector from the crisis, it's transferring the burden of this to the working people and to the working population. And this is not a way out of the crisis, and that's why we think that we should say no to these austerity policies that are forcing budget cuts that each one of us working people are feeling every day, you know. So actually, if we think about the origin of the crisis, the reasons why we are in this crisis, it's much more because of the banks' behaviors and risk taken by the banks and the financial sector, and also because of the fiscal policies that have been applied in European countries. With the fiscal competition between countries, and Ireland was an example of this fiscal competition where corporate benefits, corporate tax went down to 12.5% in order to attract corporation to Ireland. This fiscal policies and competition between European countries and tax evasion have done much more to harm the public budget and to increase the debt, with along, of course, with the rescue of the financial sector. So when we hear every day about how we have to be responsible, we working people have to be more responsible, and why there should be more austerity measures and more cuts in the public services, we understand that this is not a way out and we are not responsible, and that's why we should, you know, tell a different story about what happened and why we are here today and what's happening. Since the beginning of the financial crisis and at the height of the financial crisis, we saw different leaders in Europe and around the world meet and say, never again, never again. We will not let ever again the financial sector behave this way. But today we are, you know, totally right to ask ourselves what has been done and what kind of regulation has been implemented so this never happens again. And actually, if you look at it, we still have a long, long road ahead of us to make sure that this never happens again, because everything is still in place for it to happen again and again. And actually, every time they try to get us out of the crisis, what happens is that they create the condition of a new crisis ahead of us. That's why I would like today to take the question of the shadow banking, just to illustrate how much the regulation is far behind what it needs to be today if we were to get out of the crisis, and how much the regulators have been captured by the financial sectors, and that banks are still today, the financial sector is still today, we would like it not to behave, and that's why we think that the financial sector should be put under social control in order to stop the conditions for a new crisis to rise again. What is the shadow banking system, and what does it do, and is it today controlled, and what can we do about it? So shadow banking system, in a very simple way, it's financial institutions acting like banks, but they are not banks. And they are not subject to regulation like banks are, in terms of capital requirements, in terms of other regulation, and in terms of skills and monitoring. These are financial institutions that are acting like banks, but they are not banks. The Financial Stability Board gives two different definitions that basically says what I just said, you know, which is it's a system of credit intermediation involving entities and activities outside the regular banking system, and it raises concerns, systemic risk concerns, because of the regulatory arbitrage that it implies, because banks will put, you know, some of these activities in these entities to escape the capital requirements and the regulation. I like the European Economic and Social Committee definition because something about it that speaks to me. It says there are many ways in which shadow banks replicate traditional banks, and some shadow banks are part of traditional banks. And that's what I like about this definition, because it actually shows that shadow banks could be inside traditional banks, which is a lot the case in Europe, and it could be outside the traditional banks. What are the distinctive features of the shadow banking? It does what banks do. It does maturity transformation, it uses leverage, and it does money creation. But it does not have the regulation it should be subjected to. If we look at traditional banking intermediation, you could see how it happens. Household savings, deposits their saving in commercial retail banks, and banks give credit and long-term loans. But these commercial banks have requirements and have skills. You cannot be, not every entity could become a bank just like that, you know. Commercial banks have certain skills to monitor and certain means to monitor these loans, and they hold these loans, so they have an incentive to monitor these loans. Whereas shadow banking intermediation is different in the sense that it gives credit, but it does not hold these credit these loans, and so therefore it does not have the means or the skills to monitor these loans or the incentive to do so, because it's spread outside of the regular banking system. So you have the saving, the household depositing savings, and, you know, in institutions like money market funds or hedge funds or other entities that are not retail banks, and these entities create, you know, conducts and special investment vehicles, and then they sell these loans under security, you know, they make them marketable securities, and these securities are sold again to other investors. That's exactly what happened during the subprime crisis in the United States, and we all know about how these entities were not capable of monitoring what happened to these securities that got spread. No one knew exactly where they were, and banks were involved in selling these securities, which received, you know, very good grades from the rating agencies, and were spread, bundled with other securities, and so you couldn't tell where the toxic securities were because they were bundled with other securities. And so this is a perfect example about how not every entity could become a bank and has capacity of monitoring the loans. So actually, a lot of people would say, okay, so, you know, shadow banking, but the shadow banking system is an American phenomena. It's only in the United States. It's a subprime crisis, and that's why it came to Europe, but we are not responsible for the subprime crisis, and there is no shadow banking in Europe. This is more an American phenomena, and its consequences, because of the contagion, it came to Europe, but we Europeans don't have anything to do with the shadow banking system. What actually, if you look at it, you know, this European shadow banking system exists. And it's actually larger than the American shadow banking system. The figures are here given by the Financial Stability Board. The global shadow banking system went from $26 trillion in 2002 to $67 trillion in 2011, of which $23 trillion are American, and the euro area it's $22 trillion, and if you put the UK with the euro area, you end up with $31 trillion dollars, which is far superior to the American shadow banking system assets. So put together, the euro area and the UK shadow banking system is larger than the American system, and it's not just an American phenomena. It's very well existing. It exists in Europe, and it's doing quite well, actually. How does it function? We said it's non-banks doing the jobs that banks do usually, but how does it function? Securitization is a very good way, it's a practice used by the shadow banking system, because it would take cash flow producing assets and convert them into securities and sell them. Very often, the securities that are sold are either commercial mortgage securities or residential mortgage security, asset-backed securities. So if we look at and it's done through entities outside of the banks, either financial vehicle corporations or, as I said, hedge funds, money market funds, etc., special investment vehicles. The instruments that are used, as I said, it depends in Europe. These instruments depend according to the country. Each country has more specific instruments. But overall, it's the commercial mortgage-backed securities and the residential mortgage-backed securities that have the most important share. And the instruments, at least in 2012 in Europe. If you would like to take a look at the financial vehicle corporations, and you would be quite impressed by the long list of financial vehicle corporation, here is the link on the ECB website. You will find that there are very, very numerous financial vehicle corporations that exist in different European countries, and they are very much used to commercialize to sell this asset-backed securities. Sometimes the financial vehicle corporation are created just for one type of securities for one shot. Sometimes they exist longer, and they are for different type of securities and for different occasions. So, if we take a look at the European shadow banking system, it has some specific features compared to the American shadow banking system. In Europe, shadow banking activities are very much intertwined and part of the universal banks because of the universal banking models that exist much more in Europe than in the United States, and because of the existence in the past before of the Glass-Steagall Act that separated investment banks from retail banking in the United States. But in Europe, shadow banking activities are very much linked directly to the universal banks. Because, as I said, universal banking has been a dominant model in continental Europe for a long time. For instance, if you take a look at the banking balance sheets of the major French banks, this is very obvious. On the asset sides, you could look at the customer loans. The share of the customer loans went from 1980, from 84% of the assets to 30%. You know, a big decline, a steep decline. And at the same time, the part of the securities, which are market activities, went from 5% to 55% on the asset sides. You have the same phenomena happening on the liability sides, because the customer deposits went from 73% to 24% of the total of the liabilities in the bank balance sheet. And on the other side, the securities, the market activities went from 6% to 54%. These figures show very clearly what we call the financialization of the balance sheet of banks. At least in France, it's very clear that you have that the retail activities of the banks went down as the share of their total activities, and that the banks are much more active today on the financial markets as part of their activities. For those of you who know the traditional opposition between bank-based and market-based, it's not exactly well adapted to the European context and to countries like France, for instance, because the banks are actually the most active, the most major players on the financial markets. So this opposition, bank-based, market-based, takeaway does not highlight the fact that the banks are the major players on the market today. And shadow banking could be viewed as an extension of the market-based activity of the banks, using, you know, arbitrage, to regulatory arbitrage, to escape some of the capital requirements and to go on the financial market using the financial innovations, derivative products and securitization, much more in their activities, which shows that not only financialization is taking place, but speculation as activities are a bigger part of their activities than just their traditional retail banking activities. Here's an example of the structure of a major bank in France, Société Générale. If you look at the left-hand side, where it says Banque de Détail and Services Financiers, that square on the left-hand side, this is the retail banking. And next to the retail banking activities, you have the corporate and investment banking, the private asset management and private banking, and all that follows that are part of the banking activities. And that gives you a good picture of how retail activities have been marginalized, have become a very small part of the banking activities. The traditional activities are becoming a very small part of the overall activities of the bank. And for me, everything except the retail banking is part of the shadow banking. And this shadow banking, because you do not apply the capital requirements to these other activities. And so if in the United States, a big part of these entities are outside of the banks, in Europe, in continental Europe, with the universal banking model, a big part of the shadow banking activities is part of the bank. And if we look today at the links between the European shadow banking and the American shadow banking activities, these links are very, very strong. There is a big interconnection between the two shadow banking systems. Because the US has traditionally a very large asset management industry, and that the European banks thought that could use these expertise and these activities of the asset management industry, and they were very active, and that's why there is a very strong interconnection between the two shadow banking systems, and why the European banks played a major role in the crisis that erupted and in the contagion of the crisis to Europe. It's not just the American banks, European banks are very active and major players in this system. European banks were large receivers of short-term dollar funding from the American money market funds, and they were at the same time buyers, major buyers of US securities and structured credit. Actually, there are different proofs of that. One of them is the amount that European banks received when the American government bailed out AIG, for instance. Société Générale headed the list, receiving $11 billion, or 22% of the total. And the French Calillon, which is Crédit Agricole Investment Bank, also received money as part of the bailout because they were very much linked to this these kind of activities. This shows very well how European global banks, this is taken from Shin, shows very much how European global banks played an important role between US savers and borrowers, buying, you know, securities and receiving also funds from the money market funds. And also, as I said before, there are direct links between banks and the shadow banks. And there are indirect links at the same time. Direct links is when, you know, there is a guarantee, implicit or explicit, given by the banks or their reputation, even if they did not hold to the security sold. There are direct links because of the guarantees that are given, or because also of the reputation phenomena where the banks has to step in and bail out, you know, or come to the rescue of some of these entities that they helped created. Or there are indirect linkages because, say, both banks and these entities, the shadow banks, are exposed to the same kind of assets and to the same counterparties. And so when any events happens, so it's amplified, the phenomenon is amplified because they are both exposed to the same kind of assets and difficulty, and that's what we call the contagion channel also. So the links between shadow banks and traditional banks is very strong in Europe, and this, in my opinion, is a very distinctive feature of the European shadow banking system. Another proof is when the Eurozone crisis took place because of the bailout of the financial sector, and the crisis became a Eurozone crisis. The American money market funds got very, very scared and pulled out of Europe. When it happens, for instance, US money market between June and November 2011, the American money market funds withdrew about $140 billion from French banks. Well, during that same period, it's a big amount. So during that same period, if you follow the share prices of French banks or European banks, you would see that there was a very, very important decline on the stock market because of the pullout of the money market funds. Later in 2013, when the US money market funds returned, France is still representing their last single country exposure in Europe, and they are very exposed to French banks. But here is the changes in share prices in percentage between July 1st and September 31st, 2011, when the American money market funds withdrew, got scared and withdrew from the French market and European market in general during the Eurozone crisis. You see that the Société Générale shares went down by 52%, which is quite important. Crédit Agricole, but not only, you know, you have Commerce Bank, BNP Paribas, Deutsche Bank, all the major banks were caught into this. I hope I have showed you how there is that European shadow banking exists as such, that it's not only a phenomenon far away from us, that we are protected because our banks don't do what American banks do. And there are major players, you know, in this process. So today we are perfectly entitled to stop and say, okay, you know, but 6 years later, after the beginning of the crisis, where do we stand? What has been done to stop this phenomena? And we hope that today, you know, the leaders of Europe and of the regulatory organizations and bodies have, you know, kept their promise and said, you know, we will, finance is our enemy, said Hollande, for instance, in France during his campaign. And they all said never again. So let's stop for a second and see if the measures have been taken to stop this process and if this process has been interrupted. Well, actually, unfortunately, no, and I'm not the one saying it. It's the Financial Stability Board in its report in 2013 stating that non-bank financial intermediation in a broad sense continued to grow in 2012. And that the data from the European Central Bank shows very clearly that other financial intermediaries have increased by $5 trillion in 2012, and that today, overall, is $71.2 trillion. And that Basel III, which are the capital requirements that the measures that were taken for the banks to stop, you know, to say that the crisis will not have any more the same effect, that we want the banks to be more regulated and that they should use less leverage and more capital requirements and take less risk. Actually, Basel III and the capital requirements have led to a different development of alternative non-bank sources, shadow banks again, but this time involving, you know, institutions like insurance companies and pension funds and private equity funds. And I will give you a very quick picture of the new developments. Today, you know, there are calls saying the small and medium enterprises are suffering very much from the crisis. Basel III is stopping banks from giving credit to small and medium enterprises. This is terrible. And so there are calls to say that we should use securitization, that securitization should be used to finance small and medium enterprises, because big enterprises could still go on the financial markets and use the bond markets and the stock markets. But small and medium enterprises can do it, and so there are calls to see development of securitization. Here is how it happens. In blue, you have the large corporations. They could go to the bond market, I said, and use the stock market and securitization. But in yellow, you will see how the financing of small and medium enterprises is giving rise to new forms of shadow banking. There are three different models. I will not go specifically in each model, whether it's private placement or bilateral lending or specialized loan funds or co-origination between bank and a non-bank. Anyway, each time you will see There are large funds created to fund small and medium enterprises. You're using securitization and involving a bank and a non-bank, and usually it's either a hedge fund or an insurance company, and giving rise again to shadow banking, you know, typically, and you know, which shows that the process has not stopped at all. Companies such as Allianz and AXA have recently announced setting up new debt teams to invest and so-called help small and medium enterprises to finance themselves through shadow banking. So I'll skip the three models and go to examples of funds specialized in loans to mid-market companies. If you take a look, they're very recent. It's, you know, like June 2013, March 2013, May 2013. And it involves hedge funds and AXA, the insurance company. Another example between co-origination partnerships between banks and non-banks. And here again, this is only, these are only examples from France, with Société Générale on one hand, for instance, and AXA insurance company, or Natixis on one hand, Crédit Agricole, these are banks, and other insurance companies to finance mid-market companies and small and medium enterprises. So where do we go from here, and what are the conclusions? First conclusion, in my opinion, is that shadow banking is not specific to the United States. It's not a foreign phenomena to Europe. It is a European phenomena and exists very well in Europe. That it involves excessive risk-taking, and it's responsible in a large part with the banks for the financial crisis, and it has spread the crisis on a worldwide level. The measures taken since the crisis, which is not finished, has not stopped the development of the shadow banking. Today, there are new forms of intermediation involving banks and non-banks in Europe. And so that's why one of the major conclusions should be that we should ask for a complete separation between retail banking and investment banking. We think that the two should be separated. We should have another Glass-Steagall Act with the separation between the two activities, and only guarantee, only lender of last resort by the European Central Bank to the retail banking, to the banks that are financing the economy and doing activities that we think they should be doing. We don't think that the central bank, European Central Bank, should give guarantee to investment banks or to the shadow bank entities with their speculative activities. We don't think this should be done, and that's why we should have a separation between both activities. And that's why the measures that have been taken in different European countries are not sufficient, because like in France, there is no clear separation. Few measures were taken, and the Liikanen report and recommendations were not implemented in Europe. We think also that it's more the activities that should be regulated than just the entities. Whether it's done by the banks or by non-banks, the capital requirements should involve not only the entities, but also the kind of activities being done. And so that's why we also think that the retail banks should be put under social control. They should be put under social control in order to make sure that they finance and do the activities they are meant to do, to have, you know, which is extend, give credits to socially useful activities and not to speculative activities, and to enhance profits for the banks and the bonuses for the leaders of management of these banks. To conclude, I think the rise of shadow banking is specific to the type of capitalism and the original banking systems that was put in place. In Europe, where you had the universal banking model, it became much more part of the banks in itself, whereas in the United States, it's different because you had the Glass-Steagall Act. Both the Glass-Steagall Act, when it was repealed under a big wave of deregulation that which ended up by repealing the Glass-Steagall Act. And the same happened in Europe when the deregulation took place and the universal banking model became the norm. That's why, you know, there is a strong connection between both of them. And what you see today in Europe has a parallel in the United States, where even investment banks are asking to become more universal banks and have all the activities inside them to, in order to have include shadow banking activities. You know, so it's the same phenomena, although it takes different forms according to the way, you know, the banking models that was put into place. But in both continents, it still exists and taking place. And that's why I think today we should discuss more in terms of what kind of regulation would put an end to this process and make sure that the banks are not speculating but are under social control and finance useful activities for the society. Because when you look at the way the ECB has bailed out the banks without any conditions, it is not acceptable to us that the public money be used to bail out actors, major players who took such responsibility in the crisis and who are being bailed out without any condition, not even condition on how to use the funds that are being given to them today. They use the funds to speculate against the states and the governments that rescued them, showing how ungrateful they are. So I think the discussion could take place on how we could, you know, put these banks under control. Thank you for your attention.
Hi there, I'm Gavin Mendel-Gleason. Okay, so you said at the beginning in the introduction, you said that you were interested in social control of banking, and then again in the conclusion, but you also said you thought that it would be necessary to separate out the retail banking from investment banking. But if we took banking under social control in the sense of like having public banks, would it be necessary to separate the two functions? And the other question about that is, I guess a lot of the investment banking is securitization is because people are trying to hedge risks. But if there was a single public European bank, would it even be necessary to have instruments like this? Because you wouldn't be looking to try to find maximize revenues and mitigate risk in the same sort of way. And then the final thing is that I wanted to ask is the repeal of the Glass-Steagall Act happened in a wave of deregulation that happened in the United States. But isn't that because the financial sector had already grown to such an extent that they had the power to affect capture of the sort of political spectrum? So if we're in a situation where they've expanded even beyond that, you know, how is it that we're going to get the genie back in the bottle with regulation?
Well, thank you for your question. Of course, these are very interesting questions, and I don't necessarily have figured out everything. So it's a process, you know, it's a discussion. My opinion is that we should not forbid investment banks. If some people want, with their own money, to speculate, or we don't forbid casinos, you know, where you go and play, you know, the roulette or whatever. So if some people want to use their own money and speculate with their own money, I'm not sure, you know, I want to forbid them to have these activities. I think we should, one, forbid the central bank from giving them any guarantee or bailout, first of all. Second of all, I think, you know, that the taxation should be in such a way as to dissuade, convince people that these activities are not so profitable. I am against, you know, just forbidding activities, saying you are not allowed, you can't, it's forbidden. I think, you know, the way the system should function is that people will naturally not find incentives or an interest, because actually, if you look at it, investment banks are not really so, in French, there is, you could do a play on words, it's called banque d'affaires, investment banks. They're not such a great, you know, business opportunity. Business banks are not such a great business once you take away the implicit guarantee given to them and the fact that they are part of a conglomerate that helps them exist. If you separate them, business banks are not anymore a good business for bankers, and I think that will dissuade them from really entering these activities because they're not that profitable. They are only profitable because they're getting the guarantee, the bailout guarantee, and because it helps improve all the profits with all the speculations that they are doing. Once you tax the speculation, and once you don't give the guarantee and people are taking the risk on their own, I'm not sure, you know, they will still be very interested in keeping this activity if it's much less profitable. But of course, I do believe that banks are necessary because they are necessary to, they create money. That's one way to extend credit to the economy. And if we want the economy to function, we need banks. But we want the banks to do and to finance activities that are socially needed. We don't want them to finance unnecessary projects or do not correspond to social needs. And so that's why I think, you know, that the retail banks should be put under social control. And now, who would exercise the social control and how it would be done? I'm not exactly completely sure of how it should be done. First of all, I think that the unions, people who work for banks are, you know about the banks, and so the trade union are a good stakeholder and have incentive to monitor the activity of the bank. But I do believe that you have other stakeholders that are social, you know, groups and civil society organization, and I think also you should have regulatory bodies that are involved in the state, so to make sure that the retail banking are doing their job and financing the social activities as it should be done. You are totally right also on the repeal of the Glass-Steagall Act. Actually, if you read the inquiry report, which was put out in the United States by the Federal Commission, Inquiry Commission, it is incredible what you could read inside this report. It shows very well how the leaders of the major investment banks were bragging about how they could block, first of all, the commission, you know, the different regulatory bodies, the SEC and other regulatory body from functioning with all the questions they kept asking them, and they really harassed them. And they, I think that the regulatory bodies were totally captured by the financial sector, and the financial sector had its say on the repeal of the Glass-Steagall Act. They worked hand with hand, and it corresponds totally to the need of the financial sector that decided that the Glass-Steagall Act was stopping them from going beyond all the profits they were making, and they wanted to keep making.
How you doing? My name is Nisha. I'd like to thank you for an excellent talk, Esther. There was one thing that struck me when we were talking about how the balance sheets of the banks have changed over the last 10 years or so. We've seen that something that was significant for me was the growth in securities. And not only the growth, but securities were being accounted for twice, both as an asset and as a liability. That seems kind of to have a quasi kind of dual existence on the balance sheets. which would be inherently unstable, I imagine. So I'm just wondering if you could expand a bit more on that. Do we count these securities simultaneously at any given point as both an asset and as a liability? Or is it that at a given point in time they're either one or the other? And if this is the case, by what process does this happen? And secondly to that, if this was the case, is this a useful proxy from when a boom would turn to a bust? Because if you have these huge securities worth 50% or so, and at one moment they're an asset, so then you're in a boom because you have all this money, and all of a sudden it flips into a liability. Is that what happened in the Great Crisis, that we had this change, or would Heisenberg's uncertainty principle maybe come into this? Thank you.
No, but it's a good question. You had securities on both sides of the balance sheet. You had securities because they were selling, you know, some securities, and you had, you know, also securities because they were buying some securities. So it's not the same securities. It's different securities. Market activities were on both sides, you know, of that's why, you know, you see it on both sides. There are different securities, different activities, but in both cases, there were activities taking place because of the role that which banks were, you know, that banks were playing, you know, on the market. Now, this is done on the balance sheet, but of course, a major part of the securities were off balance sheets, and that's, you could see it, you know. And so now, you know, my job, because I'm not finished with this research. Now my job is to go and look at the off-balance sheets of banks and try to figure out exactly what part, you know, are shadow banking activities, which is not very, very easy to be done because we do not, you know, have access all the time, and because the European Central Bank does not give, you know, these activities per bank. You have to figure out on the other financial intermediaries figures to try to aggregate all the figures to try to figure out the size of the shadow banking activities. So you could see the activity of banks on both sides, whether they are buying themselves securities or whether they are selling loans that they extended, and they put them and they start selling them as securities, and these are asset-backed securities.
During the time when Glass-Steagall was being revoked, was there similar European legislation or British, French and American national state legislation that was removed? In other words, was there, in terms of short-term goals for a European movement, is there sort of legislation there that we could ask to be reintroduced on the road to this changing of the system?
Yes, there were legislation, but I think they were different from one country to another. Because, for instance, in France, if you look at the legislation and the deregulations that took place, you start seeing signs of the deregulation in the 1964, slightly. And then really the founding Deregulation Act took place in 1984, you know, in the beginning of the 80s, to allow the universal banking totally. And today, it's a very, very major question, because if there is one thing that the bankers are very upset with or very eager to defend, at least I could talk for France, it's the universal banking model. There is such a big propaganda on this question. They have put all their weight, all their forces into challenging anyone who would question this. I give you a few examples. One of them is that the propaganda goes, look at the French banks. They are doing very well. Why? Because it's the universal banking model. Because of the diversification, because of they have different activities, that's why the banks are doing so well. Otherwise, if it was not for universal banking, if we did not have retail activities, investment banking, all in the same kind, in the same one structure, then the banks would have been in very, very bad shape. But today they are doing well because of the universal banking model. That's how the story goes, you know, with the bankers in France. But the truth is, if you start examining, you know, what is going on in the balance sheet, etc., you could see all the loss that they exposed the bank to because of the speculation, and the speculation was part of the investment banking, okay? There were a lot, you know, big loss, and the bailout, you know, that's why it's, we need, you know, to audit what happened. There is really some stories being told that are incredible. In France, they will tell you that, okay, the government came, the central bank came to the rescue of the banks, but it didn't cost a penny. It didn't cost a penny, quite the contrary. Actually, you know, the government, the central bank made some money out of rescuing the banks, you know? Okay, then you need a whole, that's why we need committees that audit the debt and show that the rescue of the banks cost the bank debts, and the rescue, the bailout of banks was transferred to the government. And that in itself was a big burden on the government and on the public debt. And that today, when you are asking the citizens and the people, the working people, to make sacrifices, you are asking them, you know, to pay for something they are not responsible for, and the banks did not pay for their acts, for their behavior. And actually, there were no conditions whatsoever put on the money that was extended, was given to the banks. No condition whatsoever. Okay? They were able to find, you know, money to rescue the banks, but not, you know, to come to the bailout of countries like, they put, you know, drastic condition on Greece, on Spain, on Italy, on Portugal, you know, on all the countries to have access to the emergency funds. And there were no conditions put on banks, you know, and the money that was extended to the banks was used to speculate on the government bonds. You know, that's how, you know, they thanked the governments for bailing them out. And I think, you know, here in Ireland, you know, I hope you will talk about it. There is a lot to be said on the institutions that was created, the bad banks that was created to bail out the banks. There is a lot to be said, you know, on no condition were given. I thought that at least one thing could be done, which is to say we are lending money to the banks at almost 0%, but the interest rate should change according to what use is being made with these funds. If these funds are made to invest in the economy and help, you know, useful projects, I understand. But if these funds are being used, they are, you know, given at 0% interest rate, and they are given to speculate against countries like Greece and Spain and Portugal, I don't see why. I don't see why. No conditions are being, you know, put on these funds, which is outrageous, because these are private players, you know, speculating against states.
Donal McCorry. An alternative place for working class people in particular, but for all citizens, to save their money and also to get loans is the credit union movement, which has a totally different ethos to the banking. It is a non-for-profit ethos. And even not one credit union within the Irish League of Credit Unions, both parts of Ireland, North and South, not one of those credit unions, you know, got into serious financial trouble. But yet, there is moves at the moment where the banks want to get their greedy hands onto the funds of the credit unions, and through the central bank, they want to have control of the credit unions. Now, I think that all workers should become active members of the class union and go to AGMs and fight against this. Thank you. And I'd like you, sorry about that, no. I'd like you to, I don't know how extensive class unions are in continental Europe, but I'd like your views on that, please. Thank you.
If I understand correctly, you are saying that credit unions didn't get in trouble in Ireland, and that you think that working class people should put their money in the credit unions. Is that what you said?
Yeah, well, exactly. But more so than that, that they should maintain, they should defend the ethos of the credit unions and defend the credit unions from moves by the Irish Central Bank to have more control of the credit unions, because the credit unions have a different history to the banks. They're independent.
Yeah, I'm sure. But you do understand that I'm not in a position to say what people should do with their savings. I'm not sure that it's true everywhere in Europe, though, because of the competition on the market. Some of the credit unions, or what we call mutualism, you know, kind of credit unions, had to start acting a little bit like the other banks because of the competition on the market, and because they wouldn't, you know, exist if they did not do what other banks are doing. And so, therefore, not all the credit union banks are as clean as you are saying, you know, but I can't take a position on the credit unions here in Ireland, because I don't know much about it, you know, but maybe other people
know
more. Thanks.
So thank you very much for starting the discussion, and a special thanks to Esther for coming all the way over to Ireland to give us this talk today. So we might just thank Esther for her time.